Lord. In Psalm 150, it says, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Who's ready to praise the Lord this morning? Who is thankful that he woke you up in your right mind? Who's thankful to be here at church today? Whether you're watching at home or you're here in the building, let's give God all the honor and praise that he deserves because he's worthy. I'll praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure, praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when outnumbered, praise when surrounded. 'Cause praise is the water my enemies drown in. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. I'll praise when I feel it, I'll praise when I don't. I'll praise when I know. As long as I'm breathing, I got a reason.
So just to recap, who are we talking about? We can do that better. Who are we talking about? 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 Come on. Who are we talking about? Who are we talking about? He's a lover of my soul. He's a provider of place is the spirit of joy and thanksgiving. Lord, we're talking about you. Lord, you deserve it all. You are worthy. And regardless of the week we had, it could be high, it could have been a low week, we are here this morning together, whether online or in person. We are together here with one voice declaring that we want to worship you. We may not be in that place where we can say, Lord, I'm going to build my life, but in this moment, in this second, that's the desire of our heart, to say that you are worthy, that we want to be in this place where we are not shaken by the things of this world, because all of the ground is sinking sand. It's all sinking sand, but we're going to build our life on the firm foundation. On the firm foundation. So we give you the praise and glory, Lord. So we sing worthy, worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever sing it. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Sing hope. Holy, there is no one like. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And the church sing worthy. To those around me, in the city of Auburn, in our workplace, in our homes, we will build our life upon your love. It is the firm foundation, as all other ground is sinking sand, so the church sings. You and I will build my.
Yeah.
holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Show me who you are and fill me. Holy, holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. And show my king, before you have a seat. And as you have a seat, check out our video announcements this morning. Welcome to Grace.
Good morning, church. It is so exciting to be here in God's house. If you're here with us for the first time, welcome to Grace Community Church. Can you give it up for our first-time visitors? Woo! If you're visiting with us today, you are family now, and we hope to see you again. So please let us know who you are and if you have any questions or needs. Scan the QR code on the screen or text CONNECT to the church phone number. Also, visit us out in the lobby at the Connecting Center because we have a gift for you. I also want to tell you about the Grace Path, which is an ongoing opportunity here at our church to lean into the core principles of discipleship and an intentional process where you'll learn how to abide and respond to Jesus. If you have an interest in baptism, membership, growing in God's word, serving, or learning how to tell your testimony, one of the steps on the Grace Path is for you. Text Grace Path to the church phone number, visit graceinauburn.com/gracepath, or talk to one of the smiling faces at the Connecting Center for more information. The Bible says God loves a cheerful giver, and we love that that is the spirit here at Grace. We want to give because Jesus says it's more blessed to give than to receive. When we give, we have the amazing opportunity to help people in need and assist church ministries in advancing the kingdom of God. Grace Community Church would not be here without the faithfulness of our Heavenly Father and your faithful giving. You can give on our website or in the offering box at each entrance to the worship center. You can also give through the Grace in Auburn app or by texting GIVE to the church phone number. Remember to pick up a copy of the Family News to learn what's happening throughout the month, and be sure to follow us on Facebook and Instagram.
Good morning, church. My name is Greg Sawatsky, and I'm one of your elders here at Grace. I mean, look at my hair. No, but I am an official elder as well. I've had the privilege of working with and supporting the amazing staff team here, And I can tell you firsthand, they are a great group of people who love the Lord and have a passion to do His work. And now we're looking to add to the team. We have two part-time administrative positions open in Grace Kids and Adult Ministries to assist in the day-to-day details of each department. Please visit graceinauburn.com/jobs to see the full job description and to complete the application. Prayerfully, we are hoping to fill these positions very soon, so if you know anyone you think would be a good fit, please pass along the information. I know I speak for the rest of the Elder Board when I say how grateful we are to have a church body so devoted to abiding with Jesus and responding to Him by serving and by being generous towards the kingdom work here at Grace. That authentic Christian community is causing Grace to grow significantly, meaning we as elders are being called on to actively plan for campus growth and for greater outreach opportunities, along with enhanced care of our existing campus. As we do so, fresh in our minds is how your generosity several years ago enabled Grace to become debt-free. There is no way we want to go back into debt now as we grow. That's why we've established a long-term relationship with Mortarstone, a Christian organization skilled at helping churches build a financial infrastructure that enables givers to do so in more tax-smart ways and to build personal generosity plans that meet their own needs while blessing for generations to come the kingdom work both at Grace and at other worthy organizations. Through Mortarstone, we elders are able to offer you a great learning opportunity. Tim Dietrich from Mortarstone will be here at Grace on April 27th and 28th to host two workshops, Developing Your Generosity Plan and Tax Smart Giving. These seminars are open to Grace, any Grace attender, as well as to friends and family members you know would benefit from this learning. And note this, no one will be asked to give anything. This is just an opportunity to learn. So mark your calendars for April 27th and 28th and text LEGACY to the church phone number to sign up. If you desire, texting LEGACY will also allow you to request a one-on-one session with Tim to privately discuss your particular situation or to indicate you have questions you want answered. I or one of the other elders or LEGACY Impact Giving team members will get back with you to answer those questions. Thanks for being here with us today. Enjoy the rest of the service.
Such an exciting weekend. These are great times to be serving Jesus together here at Grace. On Friday, we had a vision night, and really together, we're moving forward with God in some amazing things that He has prepared for us, and we're moving forward by faith together. Saturday, we had an incredible women's event here as well. Anyone at either of those just want to give thanks to God right now and what God's done already this weekend? As we gather here today, we also have a time of prayer. We do this once a month. It's from James chapter 5. At the end of this message, the elders will be up front. And we want to be doers of the word. Amen? So when we open up James 5, we read that the elders anoint with oil and God brings healing and restoration. We don't just want to read that. We want to do it together. And that's our rhythm once a month. So today, if you have an area of your life where you know you need God's touch, His strengthening, His healing, His peace, you can come forward at the end of this message and receive prayer from the elders. And there's two things coming up that are important. And Greg touched on the first one. I want to add to it because sometimes when you get an email or an invitation and there's a letter about some workshops and it's financial, you kind of wonder what's going on. And the insights as we team with Mortarstone, I'm going to share one with you that kind of rocked my thinking. It's hypothetical. But let's say there's a couple that goes to be with the Lord. They transition from earth to heaven, and they have $100,000. And they have two children, and they want to give, let's say, $50,000 to each child. They might think each child's going to receive $50,000. But what actually happens, each child receives $30,000, and the tax man comes along and takes $40,000. Now, if there was a way that you could, instead of the $40,000 going to the tax man, giving it to the church and to God's kingdom, wouldn't that interest you? that your kids would still get the 30,000 each, but the 40,000 would now go to God's work? I mean, are we aware of that kind of stuff? There's a lot of insights. And so this is an educating, it's not an asking, and it helps us. Tax smart giving. There's a lot of shifts we can make together and be intentional with the resources God's given us to steward. So that's just a little teaser, but you're not gonna wanna miss those workshops. And just like FPU, Financial Peace University, has been so valuable to hundreds of people here, why? Because it equips you, it empowers you to make good decisions, wise decisions. That's the heart of this as well with Mortarstone. So that's coming up this month. And then next month, we have something called 28 Days of Hope. We've never done this before, where every age group, every life group, every ministry, everybody at church is gonna walk together 28 days of hope. And do you know in Scripture, one of God's names that he chooses is that he is the God of hope. He's the God of hope. And the God of hope wants to fill us with his hope. And these four ways: fill our hearts, fill our homes, fill our church, and fill our cities with his hope. We're gonna talk about and actually receive more of God's hope together, and then walk in this hope and give more of God's hope together. We're gonna take a deep dive. This is gonna be a growth opportunity as well, and we're gonna experience God's power and his presence. I'm counting down the days till May. You ever have, like when you're a kid, you look forward, how many more days to Christmas? How many more days to Christmas? I'm checking, like how many more days to May? How long am I gonna wait? But instead, I really say it starts today. It starts, we don't even have to wait. God's already preparing our hearts, and it just ties into this message today too. So there's a lot of stuff going on. I just want you to hear it clearly, and so you can be prayerful as we move forward together. And what God's gonna do, it's like before they crossed the Jordan, there was a sense of like, consecrate yourselves, pray. God's about to do something amazing here. And we wanna be in step with the Holy Spirit. Today we're in Exodus chapter 7. I got one amen out of all that I shared. I got one amen. We'll take it. We'll take it. That's the good news right there. One amen. Keep sitting in the front row and saying amen, please. Exodus chapter 7. We're near the end of this series in the book of Exodus. Exodus chapter 7, the theme is empowered by God. And we want to pray together before we dive into God's word. And you probably noticed in the news what's happening in the Middle East. Unprecedented, over 300 ballistic missiles and drones were fired at Israel. And it's almost surreal when you see, and our nation has been helping Israel to intercept what could have been absolutely catastrophic. Instead, there was a lot of protection. Ultimately, it's God's protection. I'm telling you, pay attention to what's happening in the world today. Amen. And be prayerful. The closer we get to Christ's return, it'll become more and more about Jerusalem. So Jesus said, be aware, the signs of the times, what's happening spiritually and what's our role. It's no time to sleep, body of Christ. It is no time to sleep. Like, this is go time for Jesus. I'm not saying when he's gonna return. I don't know. The Bible says we don't know. I don't know, right? That'd be foolish to speculate. But I am saying that this is a significant time spiritually right now. And as you look at the headlines and different things that are happening in our country, in the Middle East, this is a time to be active, to be in your faith, not retreating and silent. This is a time to shine the light of the Lord. And so we sense that call and we want to respond. Abide with Jesus and respond. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for all the ways you protect, all the ways you provide for us in our lives individually, your goodness in this nation. God, your faithfulness as we see your promises fulfilled. God, the plans that you have, God, the purposes you have, no one can thwart them. And so we are not rattled today. We are not scared today. We lift up our eyes to you. Our help comes from you, the maker of heaven and earth. And we know each day our redemption draws closer. And with confidence in you, God, we live for you. And help us today to throw away the idols and the sin and the distractions, Jesus, that you have our full attention and devotion. And we pray in your name, Lord, amen. Do we really know how God can empower us? Do we really know how much God wants to empower us? Do we know the ways that God will empower us? We don't just wanna come to church. We want to be the church. Amen. Amen. And sometimes we say, well, I'm waiting on the Lord. I'm waiting on the Lord. And there are moments where we wait on the Lord. But do you ever stop and wonder, is God waiting on us? It's easy to say, oh, I'm waiting on the Lord. I'm waiting on the Lord. But don't you feel sometimes that God is actually waiting on us? God wants to empower us. God already is. He is faithful. We can trust God. We can have confidence in God. God is empowering Moses and Aaron in this passage today. We're going to be inspired by two people in their 80s. Isn't it good to be inspired by people in their 80s? Living for Jesus. That's what we're talking about in our church. All generations living for Jesus. This is not a time to have despair or panic or worry. Those things are not coming from God. But this is a time to be awake, to be spiritually alive, and to advance forward. And the kingdom of God moves forward, and no one can stop this unstoppable kingdom and work of God that grows every day. We have our faith in the Lord. Now, how are we going to be the church together? Going to focus on three ways that we can be the church together. First, be proactive and take God's light into the darkness. God calls us to be proactive and take the light into the darkness. In Exodus chapter 7, verse 1, then the Lord said to Moses, see, I have made you like God to Pharaoh, and your brother Aaron will be your prophet. You are to say everything I command you, and your brother Aaron is to tell Pharaoh to let the Israelites go out of his country. But I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and though I multiply my miraculous signs and wonders in Egypt, he will not listen to you. Then I will lay my hand on Egypt, and with my mighty acts of judgment, I will bring out my divisions, my people, the Israelites. And the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand against Egypt and bring the Israelites out of it. Moses and Aaron did just as the Lord commanded them. Moses was 80 years old and Aaron 83 when they spoke to Pharaoh. What did God say? First, you are my ambassadors. Now go to Pharaoh and say what I tell you to say. Because you are, now you go and now you say. Doesn't that sound like abide and respond? Abide with God. Know that you belong and are secure and that you're called. So now you go forth with the light and love of God, the truth of God, and you say all that I've told you to say. That's a picture of the Christian life. Here's another picture, Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 to 16. Jesus said it this way, you are the light of the world. Excuse me, who are you? You are the light of the world. That's who you are. The Lord already declared it. No one can deny it or take it away. That's who you are. You are the light of the world. And a town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Can we stop putting the light under a bowl? Is it not clear in Scripture? Jesus says, do not put the light under a bowl. Let's just throw away the bowls today, okay? Let's throw away some bowls. Instead, they put it on its stand. It gives light to everyone in the house. Just a couple people? Everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. As you abide with the Father, he's going to empower you. Jesus is the light of the world. When you abide with Jesus, his light shines through you to everyone in the house. There's no limits to what God can do, and it's powerful. They will see the light and turn to Father and praise our Heavenly Father. Notice what God says to reassure, because sometimes 80-year-olds can be insecure and a little timid. That's real. Every age, even though they've seen many decades inside, sometimes we get a little fearful, a little worried. So God says, I'm going to give you what to say. Moses, I'm going to give you Aaron to help you. It's nice when an older brother helps us. Amen. Older brothers in the Lord come alongside and help. It's like, yeah, I got my brother here with me. I'm not alone. And I will tell you how it will play out. Moses and Aaron, if you start to get worried about how this is going to play out, I'm going to tell you how it's going to play out. I'm going to set my people free. Would that not give you a little confidence? Would that not empower you when God says this is going to be the final outcome? Okay, we can trust that. Now, there's the Great Commission that Jesus gives over and 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 over. He gives it so many times. It's known in Matthew chapter 28. And you say, well, what are we doing here on earth? Why aren't we in heaven? In Matthew chapter 28, Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. He's the one with all the authority. Therefore, go, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teach them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Now, do you see the parallels here with Moses and Aaron? I will give you what to say. God has given us what to say. It's called the gospel. And real simple, Jesus Christ died for our sins and he's risen. I'm giving you what to say. This is what you share with people. The gospel is the power of salvation. You just shared Jesus died for your sins and he's risen. God gives us what to say. And then what else? For Moses, I will give Aaron to help you. How many people would rather have the Holy Spirit helping you than Aaron? You know, if you really had to choose, oh, would it be nice to have Aaron or am I gonna go with the Holy Spirit? Aaron was helpful, but isn't it wonderful that God himself, his presence dwells in us and empowers us to say what we need to say? The Holy Spirit, I'm going to help you with supernatural help. And then you say, well, how's this gonna play out? This is how it's gonna end. Christ is gonna return, rule and reign forever. There's gonna be people from every nation, tongue, and tribe in heaven, and we will live in perfect eternity with God forever. That's how it's gonna play out. Do you not feel empowered with these truths? I mean, God's literally just the fruits on the low tree. He's lobbing the softballs. He's like, I got it all set up for you. Here you go, Moses and Aaron. And he's encouraging us in the same way. And you say, yes, but there's gonna be insults. There will. Yes, but there's gonna be hard hearts. There will. Yes, but we're gonna be opposed and persecuted. We will. There's gonna be people who misunderstand us and are mean. Yes, exactly right. There's gonna be people who hate the light. Well, definitely. There's gonna be a really high cost. Absolutely. See, all these things are also true. But God says, I will empower you in a greater way than all those things combined. Trust me to empower you with consistent courage and wisdom at every step. Trust me because I'm greater than all those fears that you have. Trust me, even though this might be the most difficult step of faith you've ever taken at this point in your life, trust me because I'm greater than the challenge. God says, go carry the light. The light is greater than the darkness. The light triumphs over the darkness. So we drive out the darkness. We see people set free in Jesus' name. And all of this is not for our glory. It's for the glory of God. That's kind of the heartbeat with drive-through prayer. We started drive-through prayer right away. As soon as COVID happened, and as a church family, we were isolated. We thought we've got to start drive-through prayer. And we started and we came together with tears and masks and praying for one another. And then we realized we can add food and then it continued to grow and there's some other churches that wanted to get involved. And then it started to become weekly and it's been weekly the last 2 years, over 2 years on Fridays. Do you know more and more people from our church are getting involved? Because it's a way to go shine the light in the community with thousands of people driving by every day. And during that time, people pulling into the parking lot that don't know Jesus, don't go to church, but want prayer. And then prayer happens. And when you get involved, it's like a missions trip right here at the edge of our parking lot every week. And it's powerful what God's doing. And more people in our church are getting involved. So you know what we're prayerfully looking at now? Going to two nights. Friday and Lord willing, Monday. Would you pray for this and consider getting involved? You get some awesome training. You just say, I want to get trained. You get about an hour of training, and then you join an incredible team, and you start loving people in our community. Love your neighbor. This is going. Do you know more churches are seeing this and starting to do it around the sound? More churches are starting to see it and want to do it around the nation right now. God is doing something in our midst, and it's by being proactive. Not sitting back and complaining about the world today, not pointing fingers at everyone, but being part of the solution with your faith and living it out. This is just one way to do it. There are so many ways to shine the light. This is a season to be proactive together. At Grace Community Church in 2024, this is a season to live out our faith together. We're not sitting back anymore. We're just not doing it. And we're trusting Jesus. We're taking ground for the Lord. 2024, it's a significant year. Here's the second way that we can be the church. Not only be proactive, be bold, stand your ground against false gods. The battle will be fierce when you face these false gods and idols in our own lives, in our own homes, in our church, and in the culture. There are many right now. There were many in Egypt. Let's see how God works and what God does then. Let's be encouraged in what God's doing now. As we look at verse 8, the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, when Pharaoh says to you, perform a miracle, then say to Aaron, take your staff, throw it down before Pharaoh, and it'll become a snake. So Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and did just as the Lord commanded. Aaron threw his staff down in front of Pharaoh and his officials, and it became a snake. Pretty cool, pretty cool. Pharaoh then summoned wise men and sorcerers and the Egyptian magicians. They also did the same things by their secret arts. Each one threw down his staff, and it became a snake. But Aaron's staff swallowed up their staffs. Yet Pharaoh's heart became hard, and he would not listen to them, just as the Lord had said. You know what's at the core of this message today? It's how much confidence you have in God. That is at the absolute core of everything I'm talking about today. There's a range in this room in how much confidence in the presence, the power, and the promises of God that we have. And today we're gonna shift towards trusting God. Aaron and Moses, it's your time to shift and really have confidence in God. Well, what kind of confidence? Confidence that God will guide and that God is faithful to provide. When you know God will guide you so you don't go sideways, and you know with the vision there's the provision, God will guide and provide, your confidence in God's character and his word and his spirit grows. We need to step out of the flesh, step out of our plans, our thoughts, our ways, and say yes to God's thoughts and God's ways, which are higher than ours. God wants to empower us in fresh ways. And it's true for Aaron and Moses in this passage. Now, God knows Pharaoh, and he knows that Pharaoh's going to demand a miracle. So he prepares Moses and Aaron. Don't be surprised. Pharaoh's going to say this. He's going to want to see a miracle. Aaron grabbed the staff, and then it becomes a snake. But what's interesting, and the Bible's always real, always accurate, here's the details. The Egyptian magicians show up, and the sorcerers, and they do the same thing. They take their staffs, and it turns into a snake. But don't miss that verse that says Aaron's staff swallows up. Wouldn't that be cool to watch? It's like staffs are turning into snakes, and there's Aaron's, and there's the Egyptian magicians. Like, you go to the baseball game, and like, there's the race on the big screen, and you went, which one's gonna win? Which one's gonna win? And the snakes are looking at each other, and Aaron's snake just whoo, swallows them all up. Drop the mic, right? Look who's in charge. God's in charge in this spiritual battle. And that's just a small picture of the macrocosm, the bigger battle that God is gonna win. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 9 through 10. The coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with how Satan works. How Satan works in this passage in Exodus, it's a hint of how Satan's going to work. He will use all sorts of displays of power through signs and wonders that serve the lie, and all the ways that wickedness deceives those who are perishing. They perish because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. There is going to be a demonstration of dark, evil power that comes with the Antichrist as you look forward ahead with prophecy. Just because it's powerful doesn't mean it's from God. There is a power at work. It's a lesser power. God's is the greater power. Aaron's staff swallows up the others. God is the greater power, but there is a power at work in this world. The devil, a fallen archangel, demons, fallen angels, there's a dark power there. There's lies. And so this battle between good and evil is real. How does it play out? God is the light. Satan, the devil, evil, masquerades as light. It's a copycat. It's an imitation with less power. The devil wants to make sin look good. We want everyone to know that God is good. Sin doesn't look disgusting and doesn't initially feel disgusting. When they looked at the forbidden fruit, the fruit didn't look terrible. The devil tries to make evil look good. The devil tries to make poison look good. The devil's tactic is not the same. He tries to present like he's powerful, he's good, he's masquerading as the light. And this is where people get deceived and duped sometimes. And the Egyptian magicians, they had some power, but it wasn't good power coming from God. And people were impressed by their power, and they were deceived and then not walking in the truth. As we talk about Egypt, I want to say God loves everyone in Egypt. Then and today, God loves everyone in every nation. So as they practice this sorcery, God is not in the sorcery. And he's not in the sorcery today. The Holy Spirit is greater than the one who's in the world. And God's presence is greater than the darkness we see. So we don't have to fear. We don't have to be worried. God shows up with his word and his works. His supernatural word and his supernatural works. He shows up to display his power and greatness and that he is over the nations, all militaries. He is over all false gods and all idols. He is showing up in this passage to show that he rules and reigns and has the final say. Now, I'm tying it into 2 Thessalonians because I'm not only taking a look back today, but taking a look forward. And I want to give, as we go back again, another glimpse in this battle. So we have the plague of blood. And in verse 14, then the Lord said to Moses, Pharaoh's heart is unyielding. He refuses to let the people go. Go to Pharaoh in the morning as he goes out to the water and wait on the bank of the Nile to meet him. And take in your hand the staff that was changed into a snake. Then say to him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has sent me to say to you, let my people go so that they may worship me in the desert. But until now, you have not listened. This is what the Lord says. By this, you will know that I am the Lord. With the staff that is in my hand, I will strike the water of the Nile and it will be changed into blood. The fish in the Nile will die and the river will stink. The Egyptians will not be able to drink the water. Now, as you consider what was happening here, and this is the first of 10 plagues, that it's another round. There's some things we don't know. We don't know the chemical makeup of the Nile River when it changed into blood. We don't know if it looked in its appearance. We don't know if it tasted like blood. We don't know all those details. But what we know is this Nile River, thousands of miles long, about 4,000 miles long. And then from the Nile, the people would drink, they would bathe, they would farm, and they were fish. The Nile was central to their lives. And in fact, they viewed the Nile as God. They viewed the Nile as sacred, as divine, and as God. The Nile River was an idol in their lives. What did God do? Turned it into blood, the fish were gonna die, and the Nile was gonna stink. Not only was the Nile considered a god, but they had many false gods they worshiped that were associated with the Nile. Osiris was one of those gods, and it was believed that the Nile was his actually blood flow and his bloodstream. The Nile River, people would spiritually say, that's Satan's domain. That's a place where people are worshiping false gods, worshiping the river, and the false gods associated with the river. God steps into this dark scene spiritually and declares in signs and wonders and through his word and his people that Yahweh is the Lord. That he is above all false gods. He is the one true God. Let me ask you, how does God feel about false gods? How does God feel about the thousands of gods that are worshiped around the world today? How does God feel about that? Do you know what he says? I will not share my glory with another. We have relativism and syncretism, and we think we're so tolerant if we say all the gods are good. Let me just ask you, is that how God views the situation? There is one true God, and to believe anything else is to believe a lie, and not just for today, but for eternity. Why would a loving God just let people put all their trust in some idol that cannot save? And there are times when God shows up with force and power like this to make it very clear to all the people, because there's a warning in love to turn from your false gods and turn to the true and living God. And as easy it is for us to point a finger at Osiris and all these other false gods and say, nonsense, that doesn't make, you know, it doesn't line up, it's not logical. In our culture today, it is self, it is money, it is people's opinions, it is our career that we place above God, and God shows up at different points in our life, and we are humbled and realize there's no one, no person that compares to God. We like to elevate people in our culture as the top and the number one, and God says he will not share his glory with another. This is our God showing up with power in Egypt. He will expose, he will rebuke all idolatry, and God will be triumphant. Here's the declaration from Romans chapter 8. If God is for us, who can be against us? Do you know, in our middle school and high school last week, the students during their gatherings brought the word of God. When my kids came home, I said, oh, who is teaching today at middle school? Who is teaching at high school? And they said, oh, we were. And that's awesome, by the way, to empower middle school and high school students. And what did they do? They went through Romans chapter 8. If you need some encouragement, go through Romans chapter 8 today. And they stood up in front of their peers and said, if God is for us, who can be against us? You know, it's good that they hear it from parents. It's good that they hear it from our awesome team in middle school and high school. But it's also really strong when it comes from them, from the heart, with their peers. If God is for us, who can be against us? And for some of them, they are outnumbered constantly in school and in their neighborhoods. And it's easy to start to shrink back and fall into the idolatry of this culture. But that's not what we're all about, and it's not where we're going. And the middle school and high school students know our God is the great and awesome God. He is one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And you can trace it from the little ones this morning to young adults to young at heart that gather in the chapel every week, and it's the same song, it's the same declaration. How great is our God? And as you read this in Exodus, I don't know how you could conclude anything else but how great is our God. And for some of us that don't like showdowns and don't like conflict, there's some Bible passages like this that are intense and they're difficult. But it's my role to not shield you from reality, but to walk through it together in God's word. And I want to share a passage that might be eye-opening when it comes to showdowns in Revelation chapter 13, and then starting in verse 11. Then I saw a second beast coming out of the earth. It had two horns like a lamb, but it spoke like a dragon. It exercised all authority of the first beast on its behalf and made the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast. Okay, the first beast is the Antichrist, that one who's yet to come. There are many against Christ, but there's an Antichrist coming. And then it says, whose fatal wound had been healed. Remember what I said about masquerading as light, imitating. The Antichrist is going to appear to have this fatal wound, but then is going to recover. Why? Because Satan is imitating the death and resurrection of Jesus through the Antichrist. Now, and it performed great signs, again, demonic power, even causing fire to come down from heaven to the earth in full view of the people. Now, what else? Because of the signs it was given power to perform on behalf of the first beast, it deceived the inhabitants of the earth. It ordered them to set up an image in honor of the beast who was wounded by the sword, yet lived. Don't miss this deception, this false trinity. There is the devil, there is the false prophet, and there is the Antichrist. The devil masquerading as the light. We know God is on the throne, Father God. The Antichrist instead of Christ, and the false prophet instead of the Holy Spirit. It's a bogus trinity in the end times when the Antichrist shows up and people will be deceived by that power instead of trusting Jesus Christ. What I'm saying to you, church, is know your Bible, know your end times, know what's coming, study it all, be prepared, be bold, because you can have confidence in God. As this last week, the whole world was looking up at the eclipse, very, 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 very minor, still beautiful, still the heavens declare the glory of God, but compared to the return of Jesus, the eclipse is almost meaningless. The return of Jesus, it's a hint that there will be a day Christ is gonna return physically. He's gonna physically return the clouds. He returned visibly. The world will see. You say, well, how's the whole world gonna see? Just like the world was looking at the eclipse, the world is gonna look up and see. It's gonna be global, his return. And his return will be unstoppable. Unstoppable. This should build confidence. This is our blessed hope. Not a maybe, it's a yes for sure. We say, come, Lord Jesus. And in all these things, know that God's power is greater. God's return is unstoppable. God's kingdom will continue to move forward for eternity. And all of these truths lead us to not a place of fear, but a place of boldness. God doesn't give us a spirit of timidity and fear, but power and love and a sound mind. That's what God wants for his people in the times we're living in. All right, we've covered be proactive and be bold. Here's the third one, be persistent. Go the distance until God brings the breakthrough. Go the distance. This is the first plague right here. Out of 10, we gotta go the distance. Now, the Lord said to Moses in verse 19, tell Aaron, take your staff and stretch out your hand over the waters of Egypt, over the streams and canals, over the ponds and all the reservoirs, and they will turn to blood. Blood will be everywhere in Egypt, even in the wooden buckets and stone jars. Moses and Aaron did just as the Lord had commanded. He raised his staff in the presence of Pharaoh and his officials and struck the water of the Nile, and all the water was changed into blood. The fish of the Nile died, and the river smelled so bad that the Egyptians could not drink its water. Blood was everywhere in Egypt. But the Egyptian magicians did the same things by their secret arts, and Pharaoh's heart became hard. He would not listen to Moses and Aaron, just as the Lord had said. Instead, he turned and went into his palace and did not take even this to heart. And all the Egyptians dug along the Nile to get drinking water because they could not drink the water from the river. What a scene. What a scene. Pharaoh is not going to move his heart towards God after this plague. And there's going to be 10 plagues. This is the first of 10. My encouragement, you know, to Moses and Aaron would be stay faithful, go the distance. All 10 rounds, my encouragement to you, stay faithful, go the distance. Don't give up. Don't go sideways. Don't start complaining. Don't start dropping balls. Like, keep your word. Stay fervent. Stay prayerful. Keep walking with the Spirit. Go the distance. There was a commander of the Aramean army. His name was Naaman, and he was valiant. The Lord gave him many victories, but then he contracted leprosy. Leprosy is fatal. He needed healing. And then there was a young Israelite servant girl that said, go to the prophet. And Naaman, at first, a little reluctant, then going to the prophet, being encouraged, heard the word of the Lord that if you dip in the Jordan River 7 times, you will be healed. Well, he didn't like that. He thought the prophet should have done it a different way. Could have just spoke something, waved something over me. Could have been a different river. Why the Jordan? And his people, and it's good to have people in your life that are not just saying yes all the time. Yes, yes, yes. You want people in your life who say you're off track. Actually, you're missing it. Why didn't you do that? You should be moving forward. That's what his people said to him. They said, look, if it was a big ask, you would have done it. Why not just go to the Jordan? And so he said, okay. And he dipped 6 times. Nothing happens. Dips the 7th time, full restoration. It's the full distance. 7's a number of completion. When they went into the promised land and the walls of Jericho that they couldn't take down, and we've got walls in our life that we can't take down. Well, what did God say? Never before, but by faith, go the distance. The first 6 days, walk around those walls 1 time. And then on the 7th day, just imagine how foolish. Sometimes when you walk by faith, you feel a little foolish. as they're just looking down, who is this group walking around once a day for the last 6 days? But God said 7 days. They didn't stop after 4 days or 5 days. And God said on the seventh day, go around 7 times. And after you've done that, give a loud shout. Give a shout of praise, everyone. And the walls will come down. The number of completion. God, sometimes he doesn't move the first 85% of the way. Doesn't look like the walls have changed at all. But when you complete the task and are faithful, look what God will do. In some ways, it feels like we've been walking and praying around this city for 6 days, around the greater Auburn area. You say, how much is changing? How much is changing? God is moving. Keep trusting God. Stay faithful. Go the distance. Don't stop early. With faith, praising God, thanking God, go the distance and watch what God will do. Moses and Aaron, don't stop right here. The message from the word is, persistent and consistent. Just keep consistently abiding with God and be persistent with your faith. Move forward by faith. Be consistent in those small acts of obedience. Every small thing matters in this journey. So let's represent God well. Don't you want to represent Jesus well in the sound? Don't we want to represent Jesus well? Moses and Aaron, represent him well. This is what it's going to take. It's only round one. Some of our team here is going to be running in 2 weeks a half marathon, and some are running a full marathon. Pray, because what happens as we move our feet? There is more clean water for kids in Africa. For every $50, there's another child that'll have clean water for the rest of his life. That's why we've been doing this for so many years, and now we can say, look what God's done. Thousands of families now have clean water in Africa, and it could all change in this decade, you see. Stay faithful, make prayerful decisions. You might not know this in the Bible, but there's a lot of offensive prayers. I remember singing the old spiritual, let God arise and his enemies be scattered. Let God arise and his enemies be scattered. Let God arise and his enemies be scattered. Let God arise. That is an offensive prayer. Yes, we pray for God's protection, but we also pray moving forward by faith of what God would do as he's exalted and he drives out the darkness. This might be a shift for you, but we want to go the distance. I want to share this story from Jim Cimbala, who's a pastor in Brooklyn. And Jim tells a story of Easter. And it was an Easter some years back where at the end of the last service, and Easter's a full day, there was a man there, David Ruffin. And David came forward, and Jim said the first thing he sensed was the smell. It was a combination of body odor and dirt and street and urine and alcohol, and he had never had that smell before. He could barely stand there. And David came forward, and Jim said, well, David, tell me about yourself. And he said, I live in my car, been there the last year and a half. And then Pastor Jim said, why don't you stay in a shelter? There's a lot of shelters in our city. And he said, I tried staying at the shelter until one morning I woke up and someone had a knife at my throat. It's not safe in the shelters. So Pastor Jim said, okay, I get that. You're in your car. And then David said, I'm not gonna make it right now. I'm not gonna be around very long. So Jim was thinking, here comes the financial request. And the church's policy is you don't give money, but Jim thought, you know, I'm exhausted. This guy wants money. And he pulled out his wallet, and there were some fives in there. Jim grabbed his money and was about to give it to David. And David said, I don't want your money. That's not why I came up. I want to know this Jesus you're talking about. And sometimes pastors get convicted. And Jim, just in his heart, said, forgive me, God, for not seeing this, not responding with your love, and just thinking, this guy wants some money. This guy, he wants Jesus, and he wants a relationship. And so Jim shared more about Jesus, and as David leaned in, David was ready to put his trust in the Lord. And Jim embraced David, not together, and they're both weeping, because Jim said, that day, I was the one who needed Jesus just as much as David.
I was tired. I was thinking about me, and I was thinking he just wants money. But he wanted Jesus, and he led the prayer. David put his trust in Jesus. David then got involved in detox and sobered up, and then David wanted to work, and they opened up a job in the church, and David started working in the church. And David got to know his Bible so well, Jim said, he knew his Bible better than I know my Bible. He would come up to me and say, hey, pastor, don't forget Isaiah 23:18. And Jim Simble said, what is Isaiah 23:18? I don't even know what that verse is. And that began the relationship, Thanksgiving together, Christmas together, going the distance with the love of Christ. The smell wasn't great at first, but the relationship, Jim's heart needed to be changed. David's life, coming together, united. God is calling us to go the distance in 2024. Not just know a few things or pray a few things, but walk with people, lead them to Jesus, open up our homes, help them to know the Bible, walk with them the distance. Aaron and Moses, it's imperative that you go the distance. We are living in a time where there's so much false teaching and confusion. And it's in Christian literature and Christian radio. And there's AI, and there's, you watch a video and it's a bear, you don't even know if the bear's real or not. You know, we're living in that time, like, what's real? What can I depend on? And what we know is real is Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. That's what we know is real. And we just can't stay quiet about that. There's gonna be 10 rounds in this. When you think about God's breakthroughs, there's often many rounds. Think about how tragic and terrible it was when we had slavery in America and how many rounds of consistent and prayer and perseverance it took to break those strongholds so there could be a greater freedom. I'm telling you, so many people today are trapped in sin. It's been that way for 5, 10 years, sometimes 3 generations of abuse and sexual abuse, emotional abuse, addictions, drugs, negative thinking, all of these things that the enemy uses to wake people down, and God says, let my people go, because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom in Jesus' name. It's a time for freedom. It's a time for us to be proactive, to be bold, to be persistent in the power of the Spirit and with the Word of God. God wants to bring His hope to our hearts, to our homes, to our church, and to our city. We're trusting God as Jesus continues to move. And you know, there's a city, as you think about Auburn, the Thessalonians was another city. Paul went into that city of darkness and brought God's word with God's Spirit. Many responded and followed Jesus. There were also those who responded with an angry riot in a mob wanting to kill people. The light shines in the darkness hates it. But Paul says, we loved you Thessalonians so much that we not only shared the gospel, we shared our lives. Going the distance. Auburn, oh Auburn, we loved you so much. We not only shared the gospel, but we shared our lives. And the encouragement in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 5 is our encouragement today. But the Lord is faithful. He will strengthen you. See, He will empower you. He will protect you from the evil one. We have confidence in the Lord that you are doing and will continue to do the things we command. May the Lord direct your hearts into God's love and Christ's perseverance. With that prayer, I'm going to ask the elders to come forward right now, and we're going to have a time of coming forward for prayer. You can come forward and receive prayer if you're ready to trust Christ, if you want to get baptized, if you need physical healing, if you've got a relationship that needs healing, mental health and a situation you're going through now with anxiety, despair. I want to invite you to come forward. Let's all stand up as we're going to worship God together. And in this time of prayer, I invite you to start to come forward now. As we sing the goodness of our God, may God's goodness be evident in these answers to prayers. There's no shame in coming forward. You just come forward and say, I'd like prayer for this. I'd like prayer for this. So let's start to come forward now as we worship.
Till I lay my
God is holy, and we humble ourselves in his presence. We unite together in faith. We turn from sin today. We want to honor God.
We drop our idols today. We throw off the sin that entangles today. We fix our eyes on Jesus right now. God is our healer. He's healing in this room. He's healing in this room. He heals physically in our bodies. God heals emotionally to restore us. God heals in relationships. God heals us together, that we would trust God. Make those shifts right now. Repent now, so that your full trust is in Jesus. Your affection is for Jesus more than anything else created. Your devotion is for Jesus. Let God fill you. Ask God to fill you with his presence and spirit. God wants to empower you to do great works of love and speak words of truth and to be bold in this culture right now. Let God do a new work in your life. Let's say yes together today. As God heals us, may more be healed. As God restores us, may more be restored. God saves us so that more will be saved. God blesses us so that more will be blessed. We reject selfishness today. We say yes to God's hope and generosity today. God, thank you for the work that you're doing in our minds, hearts, and souls. We give you the glory. Thank you how your word and spirit work together in us. Thank you how you're changing us to be more like you, Jesus. This is our goal. This is our passion, is to follow you and be like you and live and lead and fill us, empower us today, God, that we would be faithful where we live, work, learn, and play. We are the light of the world, and we thank you. And we thank you that the light is greater than the darkness. And we give you praise what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 So good to be together today. You can continue to come forward for prayer. We have our prayer team, our elders. Have a great day with the Lord, and walking by faith together. That's right where God has us right now. So continue to come forward for prayer, and have a great day with Jesus.